Welcome, everyone. We're going to give it a minute or so to make sure everybody gets in, and then we'll start. Welcome, everyone. My name is Hugh Thomas. I'm the director for the Center for the Humanities at the University of Miami, and it's my great pleasure to invite you to our tonight's talk, but first I want to say a couple of words about future talks and then about how we'll be operating tonight. So we have a number more book talks scheduled this year. The next one is Wednesday, December 9th, again at 8 o'clock. It will be by Mark Rollins, the chair of the philosophy department, and he'll be talking about his book, Can Animals Be Persons? And then on Wednesday, January 20th, again at 8, Claire Wasletti Porter from Women and Gender Studies will be talking about her book, Gender, Textile Work, and Tunisian Women's Liberation. We also have a number of other events. We'll be posting in the chat the link to our calendar. We'll also be posting the link for the book that you'll be hearing about tonight. So that you can go to Books and Books and buy it if you're inspired. And finally, I'll note that giving the introduction, the talk, and then we'll have questions and answers at the end. To ask a question, you can go down, hover at the bottom, and you'll see the Q&A button. You can click on that and type in your question at any point during the talk or afterwards that you'd like, although we will be taking it at the end. And to introduce tonight's speaker, Melvin Butler, I'll be turning things over to David Ake from the School of Music.
Thanks, Hugh. Good evening, everybody. I'm David Ake, professor and chair of the Frost School of Music's Department of Musicology here at the University of Miami. And it's my distinct pleasure to say a few words of introduction about my colleague, Melvin Butler. I'm going to start with the mini bio that you might have seen when you signed up for this presentation, and I'll read it to you. It says, Melvin L. Butler is associate professor in the Department of Musicology at the Frost School of Music. He specializes in music and religion in Haitian, Jamaican, and African-American communities. Dr. Butler's research explores the cultural politics of musical performance, national identity, and extraordinary experience. He also examines the discourses of cultural authenticity and spiritual power that inflect congregational practice. At the heart of his work lies a critical reconsideration of how spiritually charged music making is embedded in processes of boundary crossing, identity formation, and social positioning throughout the African diaspora. An acclaimed saxophonist, Dr. Butler has performed with Brian Blade and the Fellowship Band for over 2 decades. Now that's the official bio, and I can attest that all of that information is accurate, and also that it provides key background to tonight's talk. It lets you know, for instance, that Melvin is both a scholar of music, specifically an ethnomusicologist, which is basically an anthropologist of music cultures, and a gigging musician. What the bio might not convey, however, is how deftly Melvin weaves together those two aspects of his professional life, the scholarly and the musical, and how insights gleaned from one area informs the other. I want to be clear that this is not a jack-of-all-trades scenario. Brian Blade, in whose sextet Melvin has played for the past 20 years, is one of the most revered drummers on the planet. He can hire any saxophonist he wants. He hires Melvin. One of that group's recordings, Landmarks, was nominated for a Grammy Award in 2015 as Best Jazz Album of the Year. Melvin Butler is a serious musician, and his scholarship is just as strong. He has not only presented papers and chaired sessions at conferences of the Society for Ethnomusicology, the American Musicological Society, and other leading music-oriented organizations, but he's also given invited lectures at Princeton Theological Seminary, the University of Chicago Divinity School, and a host of other non-music-based institutions. In such ways, Melvin is the quintessential hybrid faculty member, one whose efforts challenge, fuse, blur, even redraw disciplinary borders in exciting ways. He traverses other boundaries as well. His work on religion and spirituality extends beyond intellectual curiosity, addressing in this case his position as both a scholar and a practitioner of the religious rituals he describes. Indeed, the book he'll discuss tonight, Island Gospel, stands among the most insightful, honest, and engaging reflections I have ever read on so-called participant observation. Finally, you should know that Melvin is also a wonderful teacher and mentor. He's an associate residential faculty at Stanford Hall here on campus, and as you have probably guessed by now, a fantastic colleague. We are very fortunate to have him at the U, and with that additional background information in mind, I am happy to introduce you to tonight's speaker, Professor Melvin Butler.
Thank you so much for that invitation. It's great to be here. I'm going to share my screen and get started here. Okay. Is that working? Are you seeing my first slide? Excellent. Okay. So I'm honored to be here. I should start by saying that it's just a tremendous privilege to be able to share my work with an audience of listeners, and I don't take it for granted. I wanted to start putting some thank yous. If you look at the acknowledgement section of my book, I think it's pretty long in comparison to the rest of the book, but so I won't go through the trouble of reading all of my acknowledgements, but I did want to give a few shout outs to some people. Meg Homer, Hugh Thomas, thank you so much for having me. Books and books. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. To David Ake for that wonderful introduction. I'm humbled, and you're going to make me cry with that. I appreciate it. Thanks for being a wonderful chair. Of course, to the Frost School of Music and to Dean Berg, and just for providing me such a wonderful space to work and teach. I should also thank Lori Matheson, director of the University of Illinois Press, and then Portia Maltzby, a longtime mentor, and also who serves as editor of the series African American Music and Global Perspective for the University of Illinois Press. She and Melanie Burnham have taken a long time interest in my work since probably over 20 years, since I was a graduate student at NYU. They expressed interest in my dissertation, and this book in some ways is an outgrowth of the work I was doing way back then. And so I really appreciate their mentorship. And then lastly, of course, my wife, to whom the book is dedicated and who inspired my initial forays into Pentecostal Christianity and African-American churches. So I hope she's listening, and I wanted to just make sure I got that thank you in as well. Okay, now, why this book? You know the title, Island Gospel, Pentecostal Music and Identity in Jamaica in the United States. I wanted to give you a little bit of a context for how this book came about, why I wrote it, and then I'll get into some of what I see as some of the highlights, some of the main features of the book, and then I will await with anticipation your questions and comments when I finish. So I should start by saying that I'm not Jamaican, although while I was doing my fieldwork in the Caribbean, I did fieldwork in Jamaica and Haiti, by the way, and I often faced questions about my identity. People would assume that I was from the Caribbean, but I was actually born and raised in Kansas, Wichita, Kansas, and I grew up in Kansas City, Kansas. And so in many ways, this book is kind of like, you know, it's a narrative in a sense of my own journey from Kansas to Kingston. And all of the discoveries that I made along the way that prompted me to start questioning, what it means to be in a Black church. Growing up in Kansas, I mean, as I mentioned in my introduction and in my preface, I was exposed to lots of different kinds of churches, but in the 70s and 80s, pretty much, my world was pretty much white churches versus Black churches. And then when I moved to the East Coast, first to Boston to attend Berklee College of Music, and then to New York City to attend graduate school at NYU, for the first time in my life, really, I was exposed to, in a sustained way, to a plethora of Black ethnicities, people who were Black, but not African-American, and in many ways resisted being lumped together into this very broad category of just Black people in the United States. What I found instead was that people carried with them a very strong sense of national and cultural identity. This could be Jamaican-American, Trinidadian-American, Haitian-American, et cetera, from people from all over the Caribbean and Latin America. And in many cases, it wasn't even a hyphenated identity. It was just, I'm Jamaican, I'm Haitian. And these identities were not just something that they talked about, but it was part of their everyday life, the ways and the food that they ate, the music that they listened to, the churches that they decided to attend, and the music that they needed to hear in these places of worship in order to feel like they were being spiritually fulfilled. So eventually, by the time I moved to New York in the mid 90s, my wife and I got really involved in a Pentecostal church in Brooklyn. And, and we started taking on leadership roles in that church, directing the music, directing the choir, playing keyboards and teaching young people. And, we were sort of encountering, encountering people from all over the Caribbean who had been, had been in New York for generations, people from St. Lucia, Jamaica, all over, especially the Anglophone Caribbean. And so the choices that we were making as musical directors needed to reflect the desires, the preferences, the needs of a Black congregation that was ethnically and culturally diverse and had grown up listening to different kinds of music and had grown up with different expectations about what music was best suited to touch God and to experience a divine touch and to invite spiritual power into the congregation. So this was just not, it was not simply a question of musical taste, but rather this was about what music do I need to feel fulfilled, to cope with life, to get my spiritual fix, if you will, in order, to experience my faith, to embody my faith. So there was quite a bit at stake for me and for the congregations with whom I was worshiping during this early time. And this is even prior to starting my doctoral study in ethnomusicology at NYU in 1997. So my first article, came out the year 2000, actually dealt with this head on, and it's made its way into the book in many ways. But it was all about figuring out who I am in relationship to this broad array of congregants who had all of these different musical tastes and preferences and needs. And problematizing the notion of the Black church and really wanting to get across this idea that it's not a monolithic institution, that there is really no one Black church, that we really have our range of Black churches and a range of Black communities. And so I find it getting plural with the way in which I talk about identity and music, ethnomusicologists, we like to say musics, was really helpful for me during this time in sort of navigating my path, both as a musician, as a person of faith, and as a person of color. So this is why I say identity, identity, identity. Maybe I'm obsessed with identity in some ways. But as I say in the conclusion of my book, I think I'm still working on it. And I think the people that I talk about in my book are still working on it too. Perhaps much to the consternation of scholars who feel as though we've moved past that, or that it's no longer something that we need to continue to talk about it, or these kinds of conversations get reduced to something like identity politics, and like, can't we all be colorblind and be the same? My hope is that by shining a light on these differences, these productive differences, that we gain a better understanding of who we are as a human family, by celebrating, recognizing, and analyzing, what binds us together, but what also distinguishes us in sometimes important and sometimes superficial ways. I have this, the bullet point there, diasporic connections, because I have a confession to make, right? And the confession is that when I first started doing fieldwork in the Caribbean, in Jamaica included, I went with a hope and I think an expectation that people would see me as one of them, that, you know, I'm a Black person, a Black man from the United States, but there are Black people in the Caribbean and we have this nice brother sisterhood that we all share this African diasporic connection. Instead, what I encountered was, again, this strong sense of national identity. They were very quick in most cases to put me in this category of American, insisting that, so, no, you're American, we're Jamaican. And for them, that sense of national identity really, really mattered in a way that it didn't for me in terms of identifying as American. It wasn't at the forefront of how I self-identified, how I presented myself to others. I saw my racial and cultural identity as something that maybe transcended that passport identity, that national identity, and wanted there to be this connection that wasn't always there. They did, however, bond with me in Jamaica along the lines of religious faith and religious experience. And so it was by virtue of a shared Pentecostal faith that I was able to gain access to certain spaces. It greatly reduced the awkwardness of potentially intrusive fieldwork into these in Pentecostal services where people are having transcendent experiences. But being able to identify as one of them in that regard really made an enormous difference. And then lastly here, why this book, Boundaries. When I was an undergraduate student in Boston, and this is a story I tell in the book as well, I was a saxophone major, a jazz saxophone major, and at the same time getting deeply involved in a Pentecostal church there for the first time, one that my wife had invited me to. And I guess I was under the false impression that I could continue along my merry way playing jazz and doing gigs in jazz clubs, smoky jazz clubs and blues clubs and playing all kinds of secular music and still maintain good standing and still play in Pentecostal churches and still have divine favor and be accepted by everyone. But that bubble was burst when I was told that I had to make a choice. You cannot serve two masters. You, Brother Melvin, you must serve the Lord or serve the devil. And it was really put to me in those stark terms. It was like, go to hell and play jazz or give up jazz and go to heaven. And I laugh about it now, but at the time it presented a bit of a crisis for me. This notion that there's this strict boundary between a moralized boundary, if you will, between good music and bad music, or between holy music and worldly music, between music that was acceptable to God and music that would put me on a path to eternal damnation. And I in a sort of tongue-in-cheek way, I say that, well, I couldn't quite bring myself to give it up. I couldn't quite bring myself to set all of my jazz cassettes and CDs and just heaping, you know, set them ablaze in a heaping ritual bonfire or something of that nature. So I heeded the advice of the minister who told me to stop playing jazz for about 2 weeks. And then I kind of resumed, my jazz activities, and basically decided not to follow that advice. Once I left Boston, I eventually met other clergy, Pentecostal clergy, who were a little bit more open-minded about the issue and didn't have the boundaries set in such a strict way. But it was something that I continue to navigate even through the course of doing fieldwork, and to some extent even today in the choices that I make and who I decide to tell about my jazz career. I'm still a performer scholar, as my colleague, Professor Ake has said. I play saxophone, not so much these days because of the pandemic, but I still have a career in the jazz world, and I'm still a professing Pentecostal Christian. And we're not yet at a point where I feel, I think, free to just shout out to the world that I live in, you know, the world of the nightclub sometimes, as well as the world of the sanctuary. But my point is that this idea of boundaries and the ways in which they're socially constructed in these spaces of worship in African-American communities, and in, I think, maybe in the world at large, remains absolutely fascinating for me. And if it was traumatic at all way back when for me, I've now used that as inspiration to investigate, I think, in a really critical and I hope helpful way, you know, what's at stake for people when they say that you should not play this kind of music or when they say that this kind of music is not of the body of Christ. And in the Jamaican diasporic, in Jamaican context, both in Jamaica and the Jamaican diaspora, I often found that notions of religious authenticity were conflated with cultural authenticity. In other words, for many people in Jamaica, the idea that something was, the more Jamaican something was, could either make it inappropriate or more appropriate. I mean, there's a kind of a double-edged sword. They want it to sound Jamaican, but in some cases, it can be too Jamaican if it's too connected to certain kinds of popular music that are too caught up in the messiness of everyday life. So it's a really interesting and complicated negotiation of identity and musical style. And all of these issues were, I think, sources of inspiration for me as I set out to write this book. And even now, I think, in the projects that I undertake. Some methodological challenges. For me, I think this idea of fieldwork, when I first got into this business of being an ethnomusicologist, in other words, someone who studies people making music, one of the first things we learn is that, you know, that you conduct field work, that you go there, you need to be there. And of course, there's the stereotype of the anthropologist deeply embedded in the field, away from civilization in some far off locale, right? And of course, in recent decades, we scholars have challenged that a lot. And we understand that field work can also in many ways be homework, that we can do ethnographic field research in our own backyards, in our own churches, you know? And so this is another boundary that is really fascinating, the boundary between field and home, between insider and outsider. And I'm always looking for ways to blur that boundary and to sort of trouble the dichotomies, if you will. We also have this idea of participant observation, that the best way to know, you know, the field, the best way to understand music in any given society is to actually participate in it. And so participant observation is you're not being a fly on the wall, but you're engaging yourself wholly, you know, as wholly as you can in the musical activities that are taking place. And I've always felt that with the study of religion in particular, this raises up some particular methodological challenges. How far should one go in becoming a participant observer when the music that's being made, the music that you're participating in, is so deeply tied, perhaps inextricably tied, to the expression of one's faith? And this is another, I think, fascinating dilemma that I love to talk to my students about as well. What if I were to decide to do field work in a Haitian Vodou ceremony? To what extent would I allow myself to be moved by the music, to be touched by the spirit, you know, in those kinds of contexts? Now, as a Pentecostal, researching other Pentecostals, there's a cultural difference, but I was able to kind of, well, I decided, I should say, I made a conscious decision to allow myself to be moved in these spaces of worship. And I've taken the term participant observation and used the term in the book, I call it observant participation, which is just an elaboration on a term that anthropologists like Barbara Tedlock have already used. But in this case, rather than simply putting the emphasis on the participatory aspects of fieldwork, I'm also using the word observant to gesture towards this idea of being an observer of a religious tradition, right? So what does it mean to be an observer of the religion that you're studying? And what does this do for notions of subjectivity and objectivity and research? And can you be too close? And there's for a long time been a kind of stigma to scholars of faith conducting research on communities of faith. You know, the stereotype being that we lose our objectivity, or we don't have the critical skills to bring to bear on the subject at hand. And I think a lot of Christian scholars in particular face that challenge. And so I'm really grateful for the mentorship I've had over the years. Scholars like Kira Gaunt, for example, or Michelle Kislik, who've taught me a lot about critical reflexivity in writing and being transparent. And to the extent that it's relevant to the points that I'm trying to make in the book, I tell the reader who I am and where I stand in relationship to those that I'm writing about. But this is a challenge, you know, who am I? It's like, you know, the existential challenge, who am I in relationship to them? And where do we draw the boundary between us and them? And how do we write about it when that boundary seems to be blurred? So those are some of the methodological challenges. So just pivoting a little bit here now to some of the content of the book, one way that I could do it is to sort of mention some of the cast of characters, if you will. And one of the most important that comes throughout the book is Pastor Tommy L. Seals. Pastor Seals is now 90 years old. He'll be 91 in January. And he was my pastor of Emmanuel Temple Church in Brooklyn for years. He played piano during the services pretty much the whole time I was a member there. And he was the one that at some point in the late 90s, mid 90s, asked me to hop on the organ and start playing. So, and I had never done that before in church. And it was sort of like, you know, I was the best musician in the house. And so, you know, it was a small church. And this is kind of typical, I think, in a lot of churches, you know, you sort of get thrust into these roles. And so I learned by doing, listening to what he was playing. He had a kind of old school gospel style, if you will. And I was more influenced. I was more interested in walking jazz bass lines and making it sound jazzy and making it swing and having the kind of groove that I knew that would be more in line with what I was learning and what I was listening to. Pastor Seals is also African-American from Mississippi and had moved to New York in the 1940s or 1950s rather. Had been there for years and years and years. And my interactions with him really did inform a lot of what I write about in the book. And that's why he makes an appearance. His wife, First Lady Dolores Seals, who passed away just 3 or 4 years ago. There she is with Pastor Herman Bryan from Jamaica. And I lived with Pastor Bryan in Spanish Town, Jamaica for about 6 months back in 2002. And in the book, one of my favorite parts of the book, if I'm allowed to have a favorite part of my own book, are the parts where I'm recounting some of the intimate conversations we're having about spiritual power and about the role of music in inviting the Holy Spirit into the ritual. And it was a wonderful opportunity for me because, I mean, she would, you know, we would sit at breakfast and she would just, you know, just wax poetic about, you know, some of the common tropes that we hear in a lot of church services, that like, what does it mean to be anointed, the anointing of God, the presence and power of God? And, you know, at times she would lean forward and whisper and, you know, Brother Melvin, it's deeper than people say, you know, this is what it's really about. And so I felt like I was getting such privileged information from her. And she has so many interesting things to say as well about the role of women in the church. And not only in her church, of which she was the pastor, but in, you know, the differences between women in the United States versus women in Jamaica, as she saw it, and gender relations between the two, the fact that there's such a preponderance of women. Many of the Pentecostal churches in which I did my research are 90% women. Getting to talk to her about that and why she felt that imbalance seemed to be there. Was another fascinating aspect of my research. And I pretty much dedicate a whole chapter to Pastor Bryan in the book as a kind of thick description and a deep ethnography from her point of view. And it's sort of my take on what she has to say about it. The other, one of the other highlights of the book is my conversation my discussion of the Jamaica Convention. It's an annual event that takes place every year, every summer in Jamaica, where people from all over Jamaica congregate and people and Jamaican Pentecostals from the United States come to Jamaica and have a series of worship services. And they are celebrating both their religious identity, but also their cultural identity, singing songs that reflect a Jamaican attitude, a Jamaican stylistic influence. And I'll say a little bit more about that momentarily. But Pentecostals, you know, and maybe I should have said this earlier, but, you know, Pentecostalism is a branch of Christianity. And it's a branch of Christianity that places emphasis on the gifts of the Holy Spirit, in particular being filled with the Spirit, and the idea that there are tangible manifestations of the Holy Spirit in the here and now, that this was not something that only belonged to biblical times, you know, or 2000 years ago, but that there has been a continuation and that people are still being filled with the Spirit, and that the evidence of that is speaking in other tongues, things like divine healing, things like prophecy. And the corresponding understanding that the music of Pentecostals ought to reflect this spiritual heat, this spiritual touch, and so that the emphasis in Pentecostal Christian churches is often on music that's very lively and upbeat and designed, if you will, to induce a move of the Spirit, if you will. So, in some ways that the Holy Spirit inhabits the praises, the musical praises of the people, and that there ought to be a kind of physical manifestation, you know, that what is inside of you is manifested by how you worship, by how you sound, and to some extent in the music that you choose, the styles that you choose. And that's, I think, where it gets really interesting. Just a few more slides here. I was in Jamaica during a really, I would say, a pivotal time during which they were transitioning away from having their annual convention here at All Saints Apostolic Church in Spanish Town to a new venue, also in Spanish Town, but a new convention site that was bigger and could hold more people. And this kind of corresponded to a kind of modernization, if you will, of the Pentecostal convention in Jamaica, where they start to modernize their music a little bit. Modernization is one of the ways in which they put it. There was a greater acceptance of African-American styles of gospel music, whereas in previous years, there had been some nervousness about contemporary gospel music from the United States infiltrating Jamaican churches. It was a foreign influence that was perceived also as being potentially more worldly as well. So there was a kind of danger associated with African-American styles of worship. As Pastor Brian once put it to me, she said that we were talking about the fact that so many African-American gospel choruses are repetitive. Can't nobody do me like Jesus, can't nobody do me like the Lord, you know, with the luba, can't nobody, you know, over and over and over again. And Pastor Brian felt that was just a little bit too repetitive. And, you know, the way she put it was that, oh, the African-Americans are just having a good time. She was much more of a fan of what many Jamaican pastors would call sober songs that really, you know, that had more lyrics, that were hymns, you know, that were strophic, that, you know, you, and this idea that you meditate on the goodness of God through the lyrics. And the concern on the part of many of the traditional, you know, Jamaican pastors and congregants is that the Jamaican saints, as they would call themselves, are losing the meaning of the words and getting too caught up in the beat, in the rhythm, right? And so there becomes a kind of generational tension as well in Jamaica, where there's a nervousness on the part of the older folks about the African-American influence, but the younger people are watching television and listening to contemporary gospel music from the United States and identifying with the kind of blackness that is associated with African-Americanness in the United States. So that's another major point of the book. Stylistically, you know, in the Jamaican churches, I mean, you know, popular music, you know, it's hard to keep out. I mean, they, you know, the idea of many Pentecostals is that, you know, that we are sanctified, that we are set apart from the world. But despite that, I think all of these genres of Jamaican popular music have had some influence in churches, even Pentecostal churches. There's a lot of resistance to dancehall and reggae, you know, of the Bob Marley style of the 1970s, that's often associated with smoking ganja, you know, or dreadlocks, all of these, or Rastafari, these things are stigmatized in Pentecostal churches. Ska, on the other hand, this genre of popular music that emerged in the 1960s, around the time of Jamaican independence in 1962, continues to be used, right? And it's almost like a kind of Christianized ska that I talk about in the book, where because it's older, my thinking on this is that because it's older, an older genre of popular music, it's safer in some ways as an expression of Jamaican cultural identity within a Jamaican Christian frame. But just to put, when I say Pentecostal music, I mean, you know, really I should have it in quotes, because we don't really know. I mean, you really can't pigeonhole Pentecostal music as belonging to a particular style. I think it's more of a, there's more of a discourse, a narrative of Pentecostal identity. And it's really the music that is made in Pentecostal churches, which could draw on any number of things, often controversially, with some controversy. Just to give you an idea of what ska sounds like, here's one example just to give you, and this actually is not that far off from the music that I hear in a lot of Jamaican Pentecostal churches, even now. And I always chuckle with this example because it's a song called My Boy Lollipop that was recorded in 1964. And I always thought growing up, you know, when I ever would hear this, that it was an African-American singer, you know, somebody from the Motown era. But in fact, it's a Jamaican singer, Millie Small, who just passed away this year in 2020. And this is My Boy Lollipop. I'll play just a few seconds of this to give you an idea of what ska sounds like in case you're not aware of it. My boy lollipop, you made my heart go giddy up. You are as sweet as candy. You're my sugar dandy. Welcome, my boy lollipop. Never, never leave me, because it would grieve me. My heart told me so. Okay, so that's Millie Small. The other reason I get a kick out of that video is because it reminds me of old pictures of my mom from the 1960s, just the hairstyle and everything. But you can hear one of the distinctive attributes of the ska rhythm. I mean, if you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, the emphasis on these upbeats, right? 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. And so that's still played in a lot of Jamaican Pentecostal churches. And in fact, instrumentalists, if they're playing, you know, and while the congregation is singing, they will sometimes signal to one another, like, okay, we're gonna play ska, right? And it's like, and they'll switch to that rhythm and then maybe back to maybe an African-American style of playing that is more swing-based. So I was just astounded by the versatility and flexibility of the Jamaican instrumentalists that I had a chance to play with. I did a lot of performing in churches while I was there in Jamaica, in Spanish Town, living in Pastor Brian's home. I wasn't going to just stay there for free. I mean, I had to work for my earn my keep, and my earning my keep meant riding up to her church in Riversdale, St. Catherine, and playing a little keyboard for her services. So I would do that for the Sunday morning service and then stay there for the Sunday night service and then ride back with her, back to her home, each Sunday night. But what a wonderful opportunity it was for me to learn and talk about participant observation. But I had a front row seat for so many of the things that were going on there. One other thing I'll mention here, and I think before I turn it up, well, maybe a couple of other things, if I may. The sort of the controversies over musical style is something I kind of get into. It's not, of course, not unique to the Jamaican context. In Trinidad, gospelipso; in Jamaica, gospel reggae; in Haiti, compa Jésus. And right here in the United States, I think these sort of hybrid genres like gospel jazz or things like holy hip hop or Christian rock or even gospel metal, these kinds of genres, you know, that bridge the great divide, if you will, between the so-called sacred and secular, I think are fascinating units of study for how people are negotiating boundaries in spaces of worship or in their, you know, in the comfort of their own earbuds or their living rooms where they're listening to music, making decisions about what's acceptable and what's not, and how the music that they decide to consume reflects a particular cultural or religious identity, right? And it's so interesting to me, the complexities and contradictions and controversies in all of this. And in Jamaican scene, while I was there too, I was not that far removed in time from the Christian conversion of a lot of former dance hall artists who had become gospel reggae artists, people like Judy Mowat, Papa San, Chevelle Franklin, Stitchy, Gotti Gotti, all who had prior careers as secular dance hall artists and converted and started to do gospel reggae or gospel dance hall songs. And many of the churches were still trying to figure out what to do with the, like, should we allow our young people to listen to this music? It's got Christian lyrics, but we're uncomfortable with the style of a musical accompaniment, the rhythm, in particular, that dance hall rhythm, like, which is almost, you know, it feels almost ubiquitous in many Jamaican communities because of sound systems, these outdoor speakers where people are blasting music that is able to be heard and enjoyed by whole neighborhoods. And there's almost a competition of sorts sometimes between them. But this is another fascinating aspect of the soundscape. I mentioned in the book as well, a song by Beanie Man called The Doctor. And it was, the album is called The Doctor, and the song was called Gospel Time. And one of the ministers of music in Jamaica was complaining to me about the youth, the teenagers in the church. And he said, you know, they want to sing this song, Shake Your Booty in the Name of Jesus. And I was like, what? So I figured out that they were referring to this song, Gospel Time by The Doctor. Now, Beanie Man is not a converted Christian to my knowledge, but he did a dance hall record and he put one song on the record that is in a sense a parody, if you will, of Christian songs, of gospel songs. And I'll play you a little bit here and you can hear, he goes back and forth between singing these choruses in triadic harmony, very hymn-like, very gospel-like, to this sort of raucous chorus where he says, you know, shake in the name of Jesus, shake that booty in the name of the Lord. Yeah.
Who did I hear you say? Praise him. Glory now, now. Praise him. Praise him now, now. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Oh, now, now. Praise him. Glory, hallelujah. Praise him. Praise him now, now, now. Praise him now. Praise him. Oh. Yeah, I know it's gospel time now. I move to the left in the name of Jesus.
Move to the left in the name of Jesus.
Move to the right in the name of the Lord.
And could I
see you just shake that booty that Jesus gave you?
Shake that booty that Jesus gave you.
Shake that booty in the name of the Lord.
Shake that booty in the name of the Lord.
A salvation time, I'll be singing every song.
Everybody
ought to
know.
Some people don't know
who Jesus is.
Say that.
Yeah, so you get the idea there. So this is a real thorn in the side for a lot of Pentecostal leaders who like don't want their young people, don't want their parishioners, their congregants listening to this kind of thing, and don't want them to be fooled by Beanie Man, who likes to raise a lot of ruckus, cause a lot of fuss, if you will. The other song that was really popular, and I think this will be my last example here, is a song that an African-American gospel artist released shortly before I arrived to do field work in Jamaica. And it was called Caribbean Medley. And I think any gospel fans who are listening now probably have heard of this, but it's a fascinating example of how in the Jamaican diaspora, songs can be popular, but controversial. And in this case, this was it was recorded live in London. And it's just quite interesting to hear how Donnie McClurkin himself kind of navigates this boundary between African-American styles in Jamaican styles before what's a predominantly Jamaican audience. What you don't hear on the audio recording is all of the things that he says leading up to the song, where he asks the audience, like, how many of you are from Trinidad, from Barbados? And eventually he gets to Jamaica and the crowd erupts. So he knows that he's speaking before a majority Jamaican audience in London who would appreciate the medley that he's about to perform. And the things that it's a medley of Jamaican choruses, old school Jamaican choruses that many of them may have grown up hearing. What's interesting about this, and I mentioned in the book, is that he does this in a style of reggae that most of the Pentecostal churches in Jamaica would not tolerate. You know, this would be too worldly for them. But it works in the context of the Jamaican diaspora in London. And it's just really interesting, the things that he says and his plea to cultural authenticity. I'll just play just a little bit of that and then I think I will stop.
Well, then we're gonna sing us some Jamaican songs. But if we sing them, you gotta get out of those seats and you gotta dance like you're really from Jamaica. or your parents were from Jamaica, parents' parents were from Jamaica, but I want you to be true to who you are.
I've got my mind made up, and I won't turn back, 'cause I want to see my Jesus someday.
Right. So then he has the audience joins in, and he goes through a series of five or six of these choruses. And I think it's just a really fascinating example of how even in the Jamaican diaspora, ideas of what constitutes appropriate Jamaican music, appropriate gospel music, these things are played out and in very fascinating ways. So I think that's probably a good place for me to stop. I could talk about this all day, of course, but I really thank you for listening and look forward to your questions and comments. I'll stop sharing my screen.
Thanks so much, Melvin. And I mentioned before all of this started that sometimes it takes a while for questions to roll in, but not this time. So we'll just jump right into that. And first, this is from my fellow historian, Don Spivey. Of the religious forms, Pentecostal, Baptist, Rastafari, which one, in your opinion, exudes the strongest sense of an African connection and why?
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I think the obvious answer for a lot of people would be Rastafarianism, such an explicit allusion to Ethiopia, to Africa, and a contrast that's drawn between, you know, Old World, New World, Africa, you know, Babylon. It's made explicit, I think, in Rastafarianism in some ways, and also Rastafarianism being connected musically to some of the folk forms of, you know, Jamaican folk musical forms, whether they be inspired by Kumina, you know, sort of a ritual form in Jamaica, or forms of revivalism, things that started in the 19th century. But Rastafarianism is a 20th century phenomena. And I think there's an argument to be made that Pentecostal Christianity and its worship also, I think, bears a strong African connection from a musical standpoint. And I think that not only about Jamaican forms of Pentecostalism, but I think it's one of the things I tell myself, you know, maybe one of the justifications I give myself for being a Pentecostal worshiper. If I'm going to be a Christian, I feel like Pentecostalism most strongly connects me to Africa, and I like that, I think, if I'm honest with myself and with my readers. It's just, I think for Pentecostal Christians, the Africa connection is often understated or maybe not acknowledged, because the narrative tends to be that that our forms of worship really transcend these kinds of cultural lineages, and that they're global in scale and kind of and divinely sanctioned and approved. Whereas with the Rastafari, the African connection, making that connection explicit, I think is sort of baked in and lends legitimacy to the practice, to the way of life, if you will. So I hope that answers the question.
Thanks. The next one is from Sophia George, who says, this is very fascinating to me. I'm Catholic, but a Catholic from the Caribbean, Dominica, where goatskin drums, shakshaks, and tambourines were played. Just 2 weeks ago, I lamented on my lack of participation in church here, truly because I felt my loss of connection to the music and how it is experienced here in Toronto and now Miami. By reliance on this music or sound, is it a link to the spirit, religion, or a connection to our homes?
Yeah. Is it a link to the spirit or a connection to our homes? Well, oh, I love this question, you know, because it's something I think about a lot. I could sort of poke fun at the question by saying, it depends on what you mean by home. Do you mean our earthly home, or do you mean our spiritual home? Because we often say in church circles that this world is not my home, that I have a greater home, right? But in all seriousness, right, I think what the questioner asks, and I know Sophia George, right? I think the idea of a homeland, a cultural homeland, our sort of cultural heritage versus this idea of being connected to the spirit. And if there's any point that I'm trying to drive home to in the book is that I think, that people can experience both of these. So it's kind of a both and as opposed to an either or. And I think that's what lends these experiences, that's what makes these experiences in church making music so powerful for people, is that they not only are connected to their idea of the divine, but they're also connecting with this cultural sense of who they are. And it's, I think it's one of the reasons why, even in the African-American context, why we treasure our musical heritage so much, because we understand that it connects us to our God, but it also connects us to our people, and that matters, that it needs to do that. And I think there's even a kind of refusal to choose between the two, right? And certainly for Black worshipers really around the world in Pentecostal settings, I would go so far as to say that the foregrounding of musical Blackness is reinforced by a kind of a notion of spiritual authenticity, right? It's almost as though to be Blacker, I guess I would call this the holiness of Blackness, if you will, right? That Black forms of worship are authentic and good and necessary because they're also approved by God, that this is more in tune with what the Bible is asking of us, what God is asking for us. Right, it's almost like a kind of liberation theology, you know, through the lens of music, if you will. And this is something I'm still kind of working through. But yeah, I like the question because I it's an opportunity to say that it's both of these things. Yeah, thank you for that.
The next is from David Kling in Religion, who asks, "What is the length of a typical Pentecostal Sunday morning service, and how much time is given to music?"
Oh wow. If my wife is listening, she'll laugh at this, because when we were in New York attending church, you know, they had a saying. It's like, you know, you show up Sunday school starts at 8:30, 9 o'clock, and then you get there, and they would, sure enough, they say, "We're glad you're here today. We want you to spend the day the Emmanuel Temple way." Like, so, you got your first church service, you know, maybe from, I don't know, 10:30 to 12:30, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, probably. You break for dinner, lunch, dinner, in the next room over, and then you come back for evening service or afternoon service. So we would leave our home like at 8 a.m. and get back at 8 p.m. It was like a 12-hour day every Sunday for us. And yeah, a lot of that's music, you know. Sometimes it's, you know, a lot of it, I really should say it depends on what the Spirit says. There's a official kind of a program, like we start off with a couple of songs, you know, you maybe spend half an hour. Then you have some, you know, some announcements, and, you know, the sermon, and the choir has to sing, and then sermon, which itself is also musical, right? And there's sort of, you know, the musicality of the speech, but also the interjections of the instruments with the preacher. And then there's an altar call where there's more music. You know, I've never mathematically figured it out, but it might be 40 to 50% of it is music in some form, if not more, you know? But yeah, the long services and my sort of cultural outsiders who come visit church with me often are surprised at just how long of a service it is. Yeah, you know, 4 or 5 hours maybe, you know.
Thanks. The next comes from Luke Frank. In your book, and just now, you talked about the special importance of the manifestation of the Holy Spirit in Pentecostal services. How much, if any, of that emphasis on embodiment might be the result of the syncretism that occurred during the colonial period in the Caribbean, despite the efforts of Jamaican Pentecostal churches to distance themselves from some other religions? Is there still any influence from other religious practices that also emphasize spiritual manifestation, such as Vodou, Santeria, and even the Rastafari movement?
Yeah, that I appreciate that question as well. These are really great. I think I would be remiss to say anything other than yes, I think, right? Yes, I do think that there is influence from a wide range of things. I think that on a basic human level, I mean, there are things that connect us. And, I don't want to be Melville Herskovitz in the sense that I'm not saying that this comes directly from Africa. See, they had spirit possession in West Africa, and now we have this infilling of the Holy Spirit. I think it's more complicated than that. And many of you may know Melvin Herskovitz's famous text, The Myth of the Negro Past, published in 1941, where he kind of, rebukes previous generations of scholars for saying that anything that happened anything that enslaved men and women brought over from Africa was lost, and that there was no culture of in among Africans in the New World that was worth studying, that it was so traumatic that they lost it all. And Herskovitz comes along and says, no, in fact, that there are these African retentions and inheritances. But I really like a kind of a further sort of complication of Herskovitz's argument in the 1970s or so, where Sid Mintz and Richard Price have this really delightful book called The Birth of African American Civilization. And they argue that it's much more about the orientations to the divine, like ways of thinking, attitudes towards the spirit realm that were inherited, as opposed to precise or, you know, specific kinds of practices. So I think along those lines that I think it's reasonable to speculate that there's a kind of family of practices that are interrelated, and that Pentecostalism is one manifestation of this orientation. It's a form of Christianity that has within it, you know, this orientation to the divine that is certainly influenced by a range of other, you know, ritual practices, not the least of which are things like, you know, some of the syncretic practices of the colonial period, or things that were, you know, that were practiced in parts of West Africa and what and whatnot. It's just so hard to really to know for sure, right? We can't travel back in time. Like, I think there's so much that's happened, and we're all so intertwined with one another, sort of genetically and in terms of our cultural practices and religious practices. It's really hard to parse out. But I think it would be foolhardy to say, you know, to say that there's no connection, despite the fact that I think the narrative in many churches is very much against that. Like, you know, it's almost as though we want to believe that this is purely a Christian form of expression that's not touched by the world or by other kinds of religious practices. But I think the honest analytical answer to that is that there must surely be some sort of connection, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Next question is from Camille Walker, who asks, how does white Pentecostal, I presume music, differ from black Pentecostal?
Yeah. I mean, sadly, there I think there are differences. I mean, theologically, mm-hmm. I don't think there's supposed to be, right? Because mm-hmm. the word Pentecostal really comes, derives from the name of a Jewish feast. You know, the idea, you know, in this idea of the day of Pentecost, it's the same Bible, right, from which that Pentecostals are using. But there's just this long, ugly history of segregation and racism within the Pentecostal movement. If you think about 1906, the Azusa Street Pentecostal movement, you know, whole array of organizations came out of that, and churches were founded. And the original Pentecostal movement in the United States, I mean, it was interracial, right? And it's just that when these people left California and moved away from this, got in the Azusa Street revival ended, and these people went back to parts of the other parts of the country, there was, you know, you faced a world of Jim Crow laws and segregation, and basically whites did not want to worship with blacks. I mean, it was, I hate to put it in such stark terms, but you have whole organizations that to this day, Pentecostal organizations, that are either predominantly black or predominantly white. The Church of God in Christ, the largest Pentecostal organization in the world, certainly in the United States, the largest African-American Pentecostal organization in the world, you know. You've got, Pentecostal organizations like the Assemblies of God, for example, is predominantly white in the United States. And these organizations are often quite different politically. And if you think about the evangelical movement, white evangelicals in the United States, many of them are might also identify as Pentecostal. They tend to be on a different side of the political spectrum. Very right wing in many cases. And it's one of the challenges of having integrated Pentecostal churches, integrated churches in the United States as well. I just think that there are so many divisions, and although people might profess to belong to the same faith, there are still notions of white supremacy that have infected, I think, many of the churches. This is also reflected, I think, in the music as well. I mean, I wrote an op-ed a few months ago in the Chicago Tribune that talks about kind of some of the distinctions between charismatic Christianity and black gospel music, the contemporary Christian music, often marketed as kind of a white counterpart to black gospel music, and how these kinds of stylistic divisions since manifestations of deeper racial divisions, not only in the United States, but around the globe, I think. Stylistically, I mean, when my wife and I first moved to Miami in 2016, we visited like probably 10 different Pentecostal churches. Some of them were predominantly white. And this was right, you know, well, Trump had just gotten elected, I think, and we were still visiting churches, and we could not bring ourselves to go to a majority white church, even though some of them were really good, but we could just, but sometimes it was a stylistic thing. They're just like, I just don't quite feel that. But other times it was a sense of the political atmosphere, and we just didn't feel spiritually safe in that environment, you know? I think musical style, and it's part of the thing I'm trying to say in the book too, musical style is connected to all of these other narratives and values, right? Like how you worship, what style of music you play, like, you know, there's something different about, you know, down at the cross, singing it that way, not just singing the hymn, but singing it that way, that registers for people as Black. And you don't often get that in majority white churches. Yeah, so there are stylistic differences, even if the theological ones are harder to parse out. Sorry, that was a long-winded answer to your question.
No problem. I'm gonna take my director's prerogative, and even though it's 9, say we're gonna go a little bit longer if you don't mind, Melvin.
Would be happy to, yes.
Got lots of questions. Obviously, anybody who has other commitments or whatever, one of the nice things about Zoom meetings is you can leave quietly without disturbing anybody. But I'm not sure we'll get to all the questions because there are a lot, but I'll try to get some of them and we'll go a little bit longer. So Alicia Jones says, you're very careful to self-identify as a Pentecostal Christian in your scholarship. What do you estimate are the politics of that self-identification in the field of music research?
Yeah, thank you for that, Professor Jones. It's, the politics of identifying as Pentecostal in the field of music research. Yeah, I kind of alluded to this earlier, and in the preface of my book, I think I do a little bit there. I think there's a skepticism about religion in general, but especially Christianity, and especially Pentecostal Christianity, because, well, people have a number of concerns, right? One concern is that you're going to try to convert them and that you're so embedded in your faith that you can't actually do scholarship. And so this idea that there's this dichotomy, the supposed dichotomy between faith and knowledge, between, it's really a kind of the epistemological politics of scholarship, right? Like, what does it mean to know something? Which kinds of knowledge are most valuable? Which kinds of knowledge are most useful? Is the embodied knowledge of participating in Pentecostal worship, is that worth anything? Or is that something that we sort of poo-poo and like, oh no, that's okay, that's cute that you do that, but like, okay, what's really going on? We want the true analysis, the music itself, right? And so I think this is a battle that many of us have, we feel as though we're fighting, many of us who identify as Christian scholars, especially Pentecostal scholars, I think are fighting a lot. We feel that we've been fighting for a long time. Pentecostalism in particular, and maybe this gets to Dr. Jones's point too, because its associations of exuberance, of overflow, of being caught up in the spirit, of letting yourself go, being moved by the spirit. You know, this is quite different from the image of the dispassionate, cool, calm, and collected, scholarly, cerebral, intellectual, who is supposedly unmoved by mere religion, right? I often quote anthropologist Glenn Henson, who is quite critical of this in his book on gospel music and the Holy Spirit and African-American churches, right? He talks about this air of superiority, you know, that some people seem to have when they approach religious topics. They employ these strategies of disbelief. Like, we are the scholars, they are the believers. And we, of course, are enlightened scholars who we no longer are, you know, tempted by these superstitious beliefs. And that's, you know, and there's an ugly history of scholars, and mostly white male scholars, right, looking at Black forms of worship and black forms of religious practice and denigrating them, you know, not only because of the race of the people involved, but because of this perceived wildness and unrefinedness and lack of respectability, right? So this is a battle that we fight not only in the academy and churches, so to speak, but also I think even within the world of Christendom, where the more exuberant forms of Christianity are often placed on a lower, or you know, there's a lower status applied to them. They're not the, you know, the respectable kinds of Christians, right? So I think it's interesting how that kind of hierarchy, that power dynamic, if you will, also I think is reflected in the kinds of scholarship we do. whether it be on religious topics or music in general, or ethnomusicology, you know, being moved, you know. I always felt like there's a stigma attached to being moved by music sometimes, you know. It's like, even if it's not religious, like I have to tell my students, you know, it's okay to move while I'm playing this. This is the groove. You feel that? It's okay to your body. It's okay to move. You know, you don't have to just like intellectualize everything. You know, sometimes you can be like, wow, that's amazing, you know. But you know, as scholars, you know, with PhDs, it's like, you know, I ask myself, to what extent can I be moved in front of my students, right? You know, and so I love the question, because I think the politics of that are very real, and it influences us on so many different levels in terms of the jobs we get, the grants we get, you know, the book contracts we get, you know. People are intimidated and probably a little scared of this sort of spiritual, spooky stuff. On my dissertation defense, right before I walked in, one member of my committee, who shall remain nameless, said, Melvin, are you going to do some voodoo for us? I was like, okay, we'll start off my defense. I was like, that showed me where he stood in relationship to all of this spooky spiritual stuff and Pentecostal, you know, speaking in tongues and whatnot. So that just gives you an idea, but I could go on and on. So thank you for that. I'll stop. Next question.
I can also imagine what some of your Pentecostal friends would have thought about that particular question, particularly in Haiti. And scrolling down, I saw that the Alicia Jones question is actually Brigitte Johnson. So, well, but anyway, I don't think we're going to get to all the questions, but I'll ask.
Oh, okay.
I'll ask two more. The first of these is from Varna Nolan. Do you feel the African American music is moving toward the Jamaican sound, or the other way around? That's because I listened to this cultural style of music when I was young in my church that was not Pentecostal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. African American music moving toward the Jamaican sound, or Jamaican music moving towards the African American. Yeah. I guess that's this might feel like a cop out, but I think it's both. There are examples of gospel music, African American gospel music in the 70s that reflect a Jamaican style. You can take the Staple Singers. I'll take you there. There's a reggae influence in that, right? There's a whole host of gospel recordings by African American artists that are influenced by Jamaican sounds. But at the same time, I mean, it's, you know, I think these two countries have such a long history of interaction and migration to and fro that, you know, I'm hard pressed to say that there is a distinct, you know, African American style that's untouched by any other part of the Caribbean. I mean, I feel like in some ways we are all drawing from the same pool of sonic and theological resources. I think that it's been a longstanding conversation, and perhaps it's cyclical, but the to and fro, the migration, you know, the flows, I think are longstanding and probably impossible to tease out, and, you know, becomes a contest like chicken and egg, you know. So I don't really know, but it goes back a long way.
Well, there's lots of good questions, so it's a little hard to pick a good last one. So kind of at random, and I do apologize to the people whose questions I didn't get to. Michel Lachaud asked, Dr. Butler, you mentioned that when you were in Jamaica, people there saw you first as American, not as a Black person, if I'm not mistaken. I know you also spent time in Haiti. Did people in Haiti have the same perception? And what is the main difference between Christian music from Haiti and Jamaica? Which one is more influenced by African traditions, or how is the influence different?
Yeah, thank you, Michel Lachaud. I met Michel probably 20 years ago in Haiti. He's a fine musician and scholar, so I appreciate this question. And so he met me while I was doing my research in Haiti for my doctoral dissertation. And my doctoral dissertation looked at both Haiti and Jamaica. And if I had it to do over again, I should have saved one of those countries for a different project. And that's in fact what's happened, right? I have a Jamaica book that's out, and now I'm working on a Haiti book that deals with similar issues. The same kinds of issues, I think, with national and cultural identity came to the fore. Haiti is another one of these places where I went and wanted there to be this kind of strong sense of diasporic consciousness that connected us all. The Haitians that I met, by and large, are very quick to put me in my American place. And they saw me as blanc is the term that was often used to describe any foreigner, even people of Haitian descent from the diaspora who come to Haiti. And if they're heard speaking English, they get called blanc a lot of times, which means white on the one hand, but it really just means foreigner, right? So yeah, this was absolutely another place in which the distinctions between like the diasporic identity and national identity, the difference between the Haitian national identity and an American one, were really brought to the fore. Really quick, I was in Haiti on 9/11. And I just remember the responses that people came up to me. Oh, Melvin, we're so sorry about your country. You know, and I was kind of taken aback because they really treated it as though that was like my family or something. And although, you know, it was terrible and I felt bad, but it didn't hit me in the same way that it would have hit Haitians had someone attacked the Haitian capital. You know, that's an attack on their family. That is like their country. And I think for many African-Americans, we hold national identity in that sense a little bit more of an arm's length. You know, I heard Cornel West say, you know, I want a little critical distance from that thing. You know, like, you know, we tend to valorize, you know, family, maybe our racial identity a little bit more, that because of the history, you know, our people were enslaved here and we were not in charge, right? So quite different, I think, in parts of the Caribbean that are independent and Black led like Jamaica and Haiti.
Well, thanks so much. And I mean, I found it fascinating, but I think that's reinforced by just a number of questions. So thank you again for making this wonderful presentation. And I'd like to thank everybody in the audience for taking time out of a busy evening at a busy time to join us. And I hope you'll join us again for future talks. So, and
thank you.
The audience. So much I'll fun. Give a little bit of applause here.
Thanks everyone for coming. I really appreciate it. Thanks again for having me.